Damn.
Say it. So we have a special spoopy guest. She's calling in to talk about spoopy. I'm gonna need to stop talking like this.
Never.
Okay, we'd like to introduce our guest, Spoopy Kris Straub.
Oh, wow. Ooh. Master of horror.
I think you mean impossibly handsome.
I'm sorry, I was asleep.
Hello and welcome to Spoopy Hour.
It's getting real scary over there. I see some bones.
Yes.
What else is going on over there? Oh, I need to turn my brightness. You guys are actually on my phone right now.
Oh, no.
Believe it or not.
Oh, I believe it now.
Can you guess what we just... Here, let me see. Pop culture meme.
Okay. Oh, I get it. It's the thing from the other thing.
Yeah. Yes.
Nice.
Nailed it. Do you have any questions?
I get it, no.
About it? Any questions?
No, I'm complete. Okay. No, thank you.
Okay.
Fully understood. All jokes landed.
Good.
Thanks. I really like your...
If I wanted to see that, I'd just check it out on YouTube.
I really like your yes and there, Kris. It really supports me as a performer.
I didn't do yes and.
Oh my god.
No buts.
Yes, skeleton. What was
going on? So here's the thing. I was all ready to do this call. And then I realized, I don't have this attachment for my this headset, which is not new, but found. New to me. And it wasn't working. It's one of those with the headset and the mic is on the same jack. I plugged it in my phone, where it's working okay. But if I wiggle the headset in the jack, for some reason, it triggers the phone's voice control, and it triggers it to play Supertramp's "Goodbye Stranger." And if I tilt the jack up, it will do it. And if I tilt it up again, it'll pause it.
Is this a crazy movie?
I don't know why that's the case, but hope you got real scared.
Yes, so yeah. Scary.
So we know that you write a lot of creepy carbs of some sort. It's not gnocchi. It's a
pasta.
Pasta.
It's creepy mochi.
Creepy mochi.
And it's those guys with the hammer, and it's really scary how fast they go.
It is.
How delicious
scary.
It is too.
Like, you could lose a hand. It's terrifying.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Now they're good at it.
We're wondering if maybe you could share a creepy story for us.
I told you the thing about the mic.
No, that was
get scared?
But I was wondering if there's like a fictional creepy story. Because that's too scary. Like real stuff is too scary.
A piece of fiction? I don't know. Do you want me to just read one?
Ooh,
maybe.
I can, but all the ones, even the short ones I've done are kind of on the long side. Mm. So it depends on how long do you have me for? I guess is the question.
Well, we have a spooky 42 minutes left in Spooky Hour.
That's a freaking long time.
Yeah, no, you do not have to be here.
Here's what's scary. I didn't realize I was on the hook for that long.
Okay. I mean, we can help you workshop another script for Candle Cove if you like.
Yeah, yeah. Or we can just talk about spooky stuff.
Let's grind on that. How do we make it real scary? What's the most scary thing in the world to you? Go.
Climate change.
Teddy Ruxpin.
It's too big.
I think Teddy Ruxpin wins.
It's too big an idea. You can't start there. It's got to be small and personal.
Someone's standing outside my window looking in.
Toenails.
And he's mouthing.
Actually, this is a thing that I think you and other Penny Arcade people have talked about. But I also have a fear of like looking in the mirror and the idea of something like me moving or there being someone else in the mirror or something.
Oh yeah.
With that.
I can go real deep on this.
But that's a personal spoop of mine.
I think a lot of people have that one. Have you guys read the, it's a strip. I know it's on Tumblr, but it's a couple other places. It's called Deep Dark Fears.
No.
Have you seen it?
No.
It's really, it's four panels. This guy gets, what do you call it? People write in with their fear, and he just translates it into four panels, and he draws it. And the art is kind of charming, like it's not real spooky, but it's also sort of off-kilter enough to be upsetting. But the thing about it that I was surprised by is how many of those fears I was like, oh, I thought that was just me. And it's like really like bizarrely abstract. It's stuff that you'd think of when you're a kid that you would believe. And I'm like, oh, nobody else would think of that. But no, they like he has them all. And it makes me wonder like how many of these things are actually like threads through all of us, right?
Yeah.
As opposed to it's being your unique thing. Like, no, everybody's got a problem with mirrors. Nobody, I would imagine almost nobody sees a scary mirror movie. Yeah, like there was one, Mirrors, and they're like, what's scary about a mirror? Stupid, it's just a dumb piece of metal.
The idea of weird fears as a kid is an interesting thing. I'd kind of like to hear some people. I know one for mine that maybe someone else has, hopefully.
No, you're weird, Tara. It's only you.
I know. I was terrified of... I mean, it was a loud noise, so it makes sense. But like when toilets flushed in bathrooms, like public bathrooms, terrified.
Although, yeah.
For some reason, I thought there was like a ghost in the toilet, and it would come out. I don't know, but I was really scared of it. And then Harry Potter had to go ahead and be like, "There's a ghost in every bathroom." And then I went to Wizarding World, and like, there's Moaning Myrtle talking while I'm trying to use the bathroom.
Really?
You can't even go to the bathroom. Like they have a do they have like a Moaning Myrtle free version of the bathroom there?
It's no. Just a woman that's paid to be more.
No, it's an actual woman just wandering in the stalls, kicking down the door. Yeah. Ooh, I'm a ghost.
Let's talk about boys. it's just like, what's the word? Audio.
Do you not have that fear that when it's like 3 a.m. and you go to the washroom and you're sitting down and then you're like halfway through whatever you're doing and you think there's an alligator that's gonna bite off your penis?
I have actually not had that, but it's very specific.
Like similar, but not quite. Okay. It's crocodile, not an alligator.
Yeah, these are common. Hey, this unknown region got everything you could ever be scared of is in the bathroom, apparently. Yeah. You got a mirror, you got a toilet.
That's
your nightmare town. Yeah. You could drown in the sink.
Well, that's a new fear that I have now.
It's
pretty scary.
I have a fear of spiders. Mm-hmm. When I was 4 years old.
It was 5.
Oh, thank you. Thank you.
That's what I'm afraid of. That beach knows your childhood.
I am also terrified as well. I was taking a nap because my parents were like, you have to sleep because you're a baby or whatever. And I remember seeing a giant spider on the floor and freaking out and jumping up and telling my parents. And they were like, they didn't believe me because they were like, oh, you just don't want to sleep. So they sent me back to bed, and I remember waking up with the spider crawling on my arm and then onto my face. And so now, as an adult, I just don't sleep.
Yeah.
I sleep in a mosquito net that I zip all the way up like a body bag.
Yeah.
Sleep immersed in poison.
Yes.
So that no form of insect life or any type of life is able to permeate your sleeping quarters.
What about like bacteria?
Exactly.
Sounds like my Saturday night.
Kris, are you afraid of spiders?
No. I used to be, but now I'm much less afraid of them just because there's so many of them in Seattle. It's not rare. And like they're all harmless and they're just dumb. They don't want you to get in their way. I don't even get startled. You don't understand. Like, this is my problem with jump scares. It's like I don't have a startle reflex. Like I've walked into spider webs. Much like when Stefani sang about, and I don't even jump. I'm like, oh, okay. Like, oh, there's a spider on me, and I'm like, It's like, oh, I'm sorry. It doesn't bother me. I don't know what's wrong with me.
I'm
like legitimately concerned that like a bear will leap out, and I'll just go, huh, rather than get out of the way, and I'll die. So
instead of your last words being like, oh, crap, your last words like,
oh, man, I didn't expect this.
Oh, I should have moved. I should have moved.
Bear. Your last words, just bear.
Bear.
Huh. Yeah, it's real rare. So, yeah, that stuff doesn't bug me. What does bug me? Oh, it's so abstract. It's so abstract, the things that bother me.
Bring them on.
I'm a little bit embarrassed. Well, okay, let me tell you this one, because what you just mentioned about the about being scared of the toilet noise got me thinking.
Yeah.
Like, as a kid, you can take a fear of a loud noise, a startling noise, and then develop it into something like, there's a ghost in there, or something bad just happened in there, like something that's going to get you. But I, like, the fear that I had as a kid is just like the idea that something is wrong, and in an undefinable way. So it's like, oh, I'm scared of the noise from the toilet flushing. It's really loud. Oh, well, what scares you about it? What do you think is going to happen? I don't know. Yeah. It's just something about it that I don't want to be around. Like, there's, like, it's a phobia, you know? Yeah. Nobody has a, like, people have phobias about strange things, and it's like, I know it's dumb, but I can't go near cotton balls or whatever it is, you know?
Kris, this reminds me of an experience I had when I was a kid.
Where our bathtub sprung a leak because the person who had there's a home handyman who had repaired it before we owned it, and it sprung a leak and started leaking, and me and my brother were in tears because, you know, it was leaking water everywhere and we couldn't figure out how to shut it off because we thought it was just going to leak forever.
Oh yeah,
like until the end of time. That just, yes, this leak was this permanent, uncontrollable thing, and we couldn't make it stop. And it was
y'all
the scariest thing
keep,
imaginable.
Y'all are going to keep me for the full 35, whatever's remaining, because this is my jam. But, like, so another thing I think about a lot to that effect is the type of logic that occurs in dreams and nightmares.
Oh, man.
And in a nightmare, you are presented with an unending... what I refer to as a quantum of horror. You know what I mean? Like, in the dream, if you're having a bad dream about, like, work, let's say you're having a kind of a dumb bad dream, you go to work and your boss is like, where's the thing you're supposed to finish? And in the dream, you go, oh my God, I forgot to finish. I didn't even do any of the thing. And your boss wants to see you and he's going to be pissed off. And oh my God, what am I going to do? And I got to, what do I hide? No, I don't know. And you just are sitting in this moment of like, oh God, I've done it. In real life, you're like, oh geez, I completely blew that report. I guess I got to go talk to him and maybe I'll get it done today. Like, there are places you can go. There's solutions. There's stuff to do beyond that realization. But in dreams, you just sit in that moment and you don't get released from it. Like, of course the drain is not, or the bathtub's not going to go forever, but that, the child logic, that dream logic says, no, this is your life now. He's crying near this tub. You can't leave. There's nobody's going to help. You know, it's just, it's the same kind of scary logic of, like, the boogeyman, right? The boogeyman is always going to get you, but I don't know what that means. Is he going
to
take me? It's just the idea that he's coming. He's just gonna be here, and I don't want him to be here.
Yeah.
But what happens after that is very vague.
What's his motivation?
Does he put you in a bag?
The least important part is what he does after. The only problem you have is that he's coming, not that what he'll do when he gets here.
He's forever in the
So I like that stuff. I like thinking about that.
Scares
me.
Yeah. Did you have a story, Pika?
I have a really weird phobia of butterfly houses. Like, I love butterflies, and I want them to land on me, but every time I get in a butterfly house, I, like, seize up. Like, I can't...
Oh, like at the zoo
yeah.
or something. Okay.
Oh.
And I want to be a fairy princess, and I want the butterflies to land on me, but literally every time they get near me, I, like, shake uncontrollably. It's so weird. Oh. I don't know what I'm afraid of. I just want them to love me.
Is it just butterflies, or is it all insects?
Well, it's all insects, but the other insects I don't want on me.
Yeah.
So it's like the
this
birds.
This is the only one you have a problem with. Everything else can keep off.
Yeah, tarantulas
yes.
is fine.
It's the moment before. That's what the problem is. It's a countdown to the butterfly arrival. When the butterfly lands, there's no problem anymore. But it's waiting for it to show up. And they have such a dumb pathfinding. Like, they don't know what they're doing. They're not going to make a beeline where you're like, okay, it's probably going to land in 3 seconds. Just get myself ready. And it could happen at any time.
It's not like, I'm landing now. Is it okay? Can I still land? I'm going to land right there. 3, 2, 1, I have landed.
No.
No, any second. It could go for your face, your eye. It could change into something else.
Yeah.
Could just leave, yeah. I'm surprised. I think they just get blown into food. Like, they can't find flowers. They don't know where that is. they just had a hope that they stick their tongue out and one of these times I get something on there.
So what you're saying is that the scientific phenomenon of the butterfly effect, the completely 100% scientific phenomenon of the butterfly effect, we've got it completely in reverse. What you're saying is a hurricane goes on around the world and there and causes a butterfly's wings to flap somewhere else.
Absolutely. Yes.
Yes.
The butterfly is the butterfly. I think is like a prion or a virus. I'm not sure that it's alive technically. It's just a very complicated organism that is moved around on air currents. It's pretty amazing. Science. Life is beautiful.
That is terrifying
and full of spooks.
Spooky butterflies.
Yo, is this getting too, like, serious? Do I need to, like, lighten it up?
No, it's fine. This is good.
No.
What do you guys do? How often do you do these spooks? Is it always at night? These spooky events?
This is the first one. You're our first guest.
Will there be more than one?
There could be.
Depends on how good this one is.
They're here for 12 hours. You want to keep calling back?
We can have a spooky hour every hour.
State of Kris
Straub. Every hour. Once per hour for 45 minutes every hour.
Yep. And we'll have the exact same conversation every hour.
Yeah. What are you scared of? What's your scariest thing? Start there.
Sleep.
You're in good luck. You got it. Got it made.
Oh, I have another one.
It's like a self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah, let's go around and say scary things.
Okay, yeah, I'd love to hear like some spooky stories as well. If people have little... like scary fictional stories or something.
Other than being in a butterfly house, one of my biggest fears, and I dream about it so much, is people, okay, so District 9, when everybody thinks that he has sex with aliens. okay,
continue.
So, hold on. Stay with me.
Okay, I don't remember that, but continue.
So I'm always scared that something like that's gonna happen where like, not sex with aliens.
I'm just scared of life.
People are gonna.
Where
think
people, there's going. Everyone turns on me for something that's not true. If I do something bad and everyone turns on me, that's like that's me. That's my bad. But I'm so scared of yelling and nobody can hear me. Yeah. I'm so scared of like trying to change like the world viewpoint. But like if the internet storm starts, like you can't be like no, that's not. That didn't happen. Like, you can't do it. It's done.
Yeah.
And that's my most terrifying thing is that people don't understand me correctly. Don't know me. Yeah.
That's like, I feel like that's like a modern fear. Because I don't think people used to be afraid of modes of communication. But like, that's the thing that gets out of hand and then seems like it can't be fixed. Mm-hmm. I like the therapy nature of this discussion. It's like everybody's coming to me with these issues.
Is this
going to
be therapeutic? Or are we going to like find healing after
no.
this?
No. No health here.
I have a bizarre phobia of straight razors on film. Not anywhere else. Like straight razors anywhere else, whatever. But in movies specifically, if I see a straight razor in a film or on TV, I can't watch it. I have to walk away. I have to change the channel.
Does it have to be like near someone's
skin? It can just be even in the background. It might not even get used, but my brain is programmed to think, oh, straight razor. That's something's gonna happen with that. You know, it's like forget Chekhov's gun. It's Chekhov's straight razor. That straight razor is gonna do something. I don't want to be a part of that. I don't want to see it. I don't want to know about it.
Well, if you like, I mean, if it's a horror movie, like either the straight razor is there to. It's going to show up later, or it's going to fake you out for the actual thing that's going
to
happen.
Needless to say,
so yeah, you're very right to be scared of it. It's either the method of death, or it's like a precursor. It's like a little fake out.
Yeah,
no, thanks.
Speaking of straight razors, someone in chat just reminded me, because I mentioned Sweeney Todd, there's actually a barbershop in Victoria named Sweeney Todd. Yeah.
Why would you do that?
And,
that is a terrible idea.
I checked. Not next to a pie shop, but next to a child's play center, which is more concerning.
Kids go to eat.
So like you got kids saying, take me to Sweeney Todd, is it like, it's pretty cool.
And they're like, what a fun slide.
Oh, I was going to say like, I'm scared of, here's a dumb fear of mine. This part I don't think is so dumb. Like I'm more scared of knives than I am of guns. And the reason is that you can't turn a knife off.
Yep.
Ah, like, yes. I never
like,
thought of that before.
What knives are always dangerous. Like, they're always running. Like, they're always on. You can't disable a knife. But then the dumb part of the fear is that if I'm... I do this with pencils, too. Like, if I'm sitting across the table and either a knife or a pencil somewhere on the table is pointed at me, I will rotate it a little bit so it's not pointed at me. So just in case if it decided to just launch forward, that it wouldn't hit me instead. That it'll hit some. It'll go past me. Just in case. Just in case it happens.
I'm curious about this too. Then, when you're sitting with your like family at a table as well, like your parents or your wife, and like basically any part of your family, do you also then want to move the knives away? Want to not point them at anybody? Want to like get them off the table?
I won't, but I will leave them. I am still thinking about it.
Wow.
Like I'm just a tiny bit more uncomfortable than I think a normal person should be. But and maybe it's also leavened by the idea that maybe if it decides to launch, that they could get in front of it and just grab it.
Oh yeah, yeah.
If it's just like a knife sitting by itself, you don't know what's going through its mind. Like
that's right.
That could surge out right between my ribs at any moment. So yeah, no. That's got to go back in the drawer.
So as far as silly fears go, I'm a little afraid of cranes. Not the bird, but like the large scale construction material. I'm pretty sure I blame Spider-Man 3 for this fear. I blame Spider-Man 3 for a lot of things, but I blame Spider-Man 3 for my fear of cranes, because there's a scene in which a guy loses control and a crane like destroys a building and almost kills a bunch of people.
Yeah.
And ever since then I've just always been afraid of, like, if I'm driving downtown and there's a crane operating, I will deliberately take the path around it just so that there isn't giant tons of material hanging above my head at any given time.
Have you guys seen the horror movie The Descent?
Yes.
Anybody? Yes. Have you seen the whatever Final Destination is where the truck with all the logs breaks down or the logs go rolling? Like, yeah, I don't want to follow a truck that's got pipes on the top.
Yeah, yeah. I'm the same truck. Thing.
Yeah, I don't trust that they got their load right.
Final Destination 2 literally scarred me for life. Gave me anxiety. Pretty sure.
You're afraid of
everything.
You're
afraid of everything.
Talking the other day, I found out later in life that when I was a child, I actually had sleep paralysis. And I didn't know, like, as a small child, I thought that's just how you woke up. And I can recall talking to my friends, like, oh, you know how, like, when you wake up, but then you have to wait for everything else to wake up? And they're like, what?
Yeah.
I'm just like, yeah, because you can't move your arms when you wake up. And they're like, what are you talking about? But now that has developed into a fear of not being able to move / not being able to get things off of me. Mm. So if I can't...
I've had that.
If I can't unclasp a necklace, or, like, if my... You know those when you have the gumboots on and then you can't get them off at the end of the day? I will lose it. Like, I will scream for someone to come into the room, like, get it off now. Like, I can't handle it.
Yeah.
You don't have to tell the story, but if you have
one. Oh, no, I want to. Okay, yeah, totally. Something Pika said reminded me. I don't know if it's like a dream thing or not, but you have some reason to scream and it's not even important, but you can't make any sort of a sound, and that in itself is the only horror.
Yes.
You can't make any noise. Don't know why you'd have to, but you can't.
Harlan Ellison wrote a story about that.
Yeah, like, for some reason, it's just weird. And then you wake up and you're like, well, I guess nothing's happening.
That would happen in dreams, like toward the end of the dream that I'm having. Like, I'm starting to wake up, and it's like, they'd be like, explain yourself or something. I was like, read me what that paper says. And unlike my eyes won't open in the dream, and I'm like, hold on a second. And it's like, it's such a dumb thing. It's like I'm betrayed by my body.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Your brain is just not with the program yet. And apparently there's a corollary to this. I didn't know until I tried explaining it to someone. I think I've dreamed this, or maybe it actually has happened, where I try and turn a light switch on and nothing happens, or a brief flash and then the light bulb goes out.
Yeah, it's always
like,
that.
This causes me actual panic in real life if it actually happens.
Same.
And I feel like it must occur in dreams more often than actual life.
Wait,
but
so
it's just
okay,
such,
the fear
it's just
of...
to panic because there's no light. It's just
the fear of
telling you to wake up.
Oh, I see. So the light either doesn't work or it works for the second that it takes to burn out, and then it's gone.
And then the bulb is dead.
Yeah. As a kid, I had that recurring dream where I'd flip it and it would either pop or be black, and then instantly I would just be screaming and like in a black hole.
Yeah,
and then
it's
a
thing that can happen in real life, but you're not asleep and you can tell that it's fine if you just walk back out of the room, but you still feel it. You're like,
I still get scared every time a light bulb pops.
As a steward of the dark arts, I will not tell you the thing related to that. That I came across, people were talking about fears, and somebody mentioned something about that very specifically. Ooh. That I was like, no, that's mine now. Yeah. I'm going to take that one and add it to the ball.
It's pretty potent for some reason.
It's, that's a bad one.
Because there might be some reason you need that light on right now, and it's not happening. Mm-hmm.
You need it. You put your faith in that switch.
Yeah, and it's just not doing it.
It sounds like a loss of control fear.
Probably. Which, your body isn't waking up fast enough for your brain, and it sends you this coded message that will actually fuck you up in the future. Sorry.
Ooh.
That is so spooky. Look at you sitting there.
I had,
Wow, that's too scary for,
Kris just noped out?
No, I know, I'm sorry.
Oh, hang on.
Kris, are you still there?
Yeah, I'm still here.
Okay. Well, let's keep going.
There he goes. Nice. I had, a very weird, surreal dream that I remember from, like, early childhood. And it was one that just didn't make any sense. It was just, like, I had a viewpoint on, it was either some rocks or some machinery, and they were moving violently and noiselessly in and out of focus or clarity.
Absolutely.
It was just like, and like, it just scared the bejesus out of me. And like, I remember waking up and just like sitting in the upstairs hallway with the light on because my parents were conked out, and I was just sort of like, not okay. I don't know. I don't understand this. The world's really huge and scary, and this is weird and not natural. And what happened?
That's good. I like that one quite a bit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That reminds me of another one. I'll tell in a second. But
for me, it's nothing really like right about now that I've ever had. But like when I was a kid, and I like to blame the 1993 blockbuster Jurassic Park for this one, is that every time, like when I was growing up, there was a daycare
center. Fear of becoming a lawyer.
Yeah. There's a daycare center that I went to, and it was at a church. So like the first two or three floors were okay because there was like a whole separate like section for the daycare. But at the top floor above like the church annex and stuff like that, the hallways were dark and like lit just enough that it reminded me of the visitor center when the powers had been out, and I would just get the crap scared out of me that there was going to be velociraptors. I was just like, there's going to be raptors, and like for 3-4 years, like I would refuse to go up there without anybody else just because I thought there was going to be raptors there.
It's very understandable.
And then that kind of carried over a little bit later. We'd go camping for Boy Scouts and stuff like that, and I was like, yep, there's definitely raptors in the woods.
Dick, I'm super happy that I know someone who's legitimately afraid of dinosaurs.
I was young.
It's fantastic.
Hands up, everybody who's had the teeth breaking off.
Oh yeah. Absolutely.
That one's super. I had one recently where they broke horizontally, like a shelf, just like. It was bad.
Real bad.
Oh, that sounds like it'd be real clean. Like you'd have a fine, nice, even surface for grinding. Let's see, one of the most, like, speaking to that, like, rocks moving in and out of focus, whatever that one was, one of the earliest nightmares I can remember having, I used to have a lot of fear around, deep water, or the idea of it. Like, I guess I didn't like going swimming in, like, pools, but it was such an abstract nightmare. I don't even know if there were visuals, but I was probably, like, 5 or something. But what I remember was, the sensation is context free. I don't know how I got there. I don't know what's going on. I don't know, but I'm underwater in the pool. I'm submerged. I think my eyes are shut, and I have goggles on. I'm wearing swim goggles, and I take those muggy goggles inside there with that trapped air. I take them off my eyes, and I feel the cold water rush in and push up against my eyes. And that's the dream. That's it. There's nothing else going on. But the dream bothered me so much. That sensation. It was very real feeling. And we've all done that. If you wore goggles before, take them off. Like, you felt that before. But it's like, I didn't want it. So that's what made it horrible, you know?
I
chat's getting real spoopy.
The worst thing is that we're getting scary gifts. So we have 15 more minutes left in Spoopy Hour. I was wondering if we can add another guest. Sorry, engineering, is that possible?
Uh-oh.
We have to cut away from Kris. Kris, you're still going to be here, though.
Double the
spoopiness. Yeah, I'll be here.
We're going to double the spoopiness and double your fun. I have to admit right now, I can't handle scary anything. I can't watch scary movies. I can't...
Yeah. I like to pretend I can, but... Mm-mm.
No, because I emotionally relate too much to what's going on that I feel like it's actually happening.
Yeah.
I get to the point where I just can't watch it because a lot of scary movies... are the people just act so outside of the norm that I just laugh at it.
But well, see, you think it's outside the norm until you're in that situation.
I can't take the movie stupid in a...
Oh my god.
Oh hey! Ah. So joining us is also Nika Harper.
Wait, is my cam working? I don't even know what's happening right now.
No, we hear your voice. And we see...
I didn't set up anything. I am so sorry.
That's okay. This was a really last minute, like, hey, Nika, you want to jump on? Skype.
What a welcome.
Let me get everything. Okay, give me 5 minutes.
Okay.
And call me again.
Okay.
Okay.
Preview of what's about to happen. And back to Kris.
Hi guys, still scary, so.
I can do like psychological thrillers, but horror, like straight horror, I'm the same way. I get too empathetic with the characters and it.
Then they just keep dying in horrible ways?
Yeah, I can't see a slasher film because I get really sad. Except for Cabin in the Woods, which is my all time favorite movie.
It's pretty good. It's so good.
Because it's so amazing.
Cabin in the Woods, there's enough separation
it's
that I'm
film
like.
It's critique more than it is a horror movie. Yeah. Which is why it's great.
Kris, do you have a favorite spoopy movie?
Boy, this is a tough question because they all tend to be like they all veer too far in the like gross direction, I think.
Oh yeah.
So it's tough for me to describe. I feel like there's a lot of movies that have moments that stayed with me like couched in them that aren't necessarily horror, but I do prefer like the psychological stuff to like out and out horror. And here's another problem. I have a strong suspicion that I would really like, say, the movie It Follows. I haven't seen it yet. And the problem is that when I'm working, if I'm going to have Netflix running, I can't really pay attention to it. So I have not watched it yet because I want to give it my attention. But mostly it's just like Portlandia and stuff like that that I can just listen to in the background.
Spoopy Portlandia.
Yeah, they do a good job.
It follows right up your alley, Kris. It's amazing.
Yeah, it's pretty solid material. This is starting to get me into a creepy mood again.
Yay!
Because it's hard to be scary. It's hard to think about scary things when you're thinking about scary world events.
Real life things. Yeah.
And I'm like, how do I get back to feel like, novel, like existential horror rather than like, oh no, real existential horror.
And,
I couldn't,
Spoopy.
And on that note, it looks like Wild Peaks in the chat mentioned Black Mirror, which is one of my favorite TV shows. And I feel like that is a great example of real world meets existential terror.
Yeah. Black Mirror is really great. Yeah. My favorite one is, no spoilers, I won't talk about it, but it's a Be Right Back.
Yes.
That's a cutting one.
Give yourself a couple hours to recover from that one when you watch it. That's what I will say.
I've been meaning to watch that.
That one is excellent. From this season, I really love Playtest. It's also the most horror of them. It really plays with a lot of horror tropes as well as horror video game genre tropes, and it's fantastic.
Yeah.
I think we're going to try calling Nika again. So if she comes on the line, then we'll have her.
Hopefully we can
hear
her. Yeah. I can also just lose my camera, too. We could just be two warring voices.
No, but that beard.
I was going to show up after Kris left or something, if that would be easier. I can't find my microphone. I'm terrible.
No, we can hear you.
Sounds good.
It sounds
Yes. Ta-da! Yes.
Yay! There she is. It's fine. You look gorgeous.
I would have had like spooky things on and maybe like new eyelashes. I bought spiderweb eyelashes today, so I was.
This is spooky casual.
Spoopy casual. Yeah, it's really last minute. Thank you for joining us on our Spoopy Hour. We're talking about our greatest fears. Would you like to join us, Nika?
Absolutely. I've been talking in chat a lot. Hi to everybody in chat who is so much fun, and everyone is so incredible. And mostly on the idea of things like dreams. The first dreams that you have as a child is it's a fascinating thing to learn what you're scared of when you're a kid and you're innocent. And I remember I wasn't afraid of cacti, but I was very much afraid of being lost. And I think that this is the thing with children's movies and such. If you watch like Milo and Otis, Homeward Bound, or like, you know, Brave Little Toaster.
But he's getting lost all the time.
Everyone's lost. And I was a terrified child. If I couldn't see my mom or like my dad or anybody, like I would be doing something in the grocery store and over there they would have left me and I would start crying. They would be like 10 feet away, but I would not know where they were. And so I just weep. And the idea of being lost or being left behind was always something that terrified me. And I remember my very first scary dream. We were in like a Home Depot. It looked like our backyard because dreams do that to you, right?
Oh, so, yeah.
And there was a bag of potting soil or something. And my parents went on and they said, go in here and lay on the bag of potting soil and like maybe we'll be back for you. I don't think they were in danger at all. But I laid down in this small little thing. And there was a big cactus. And a cactus groped its way in. Like I'm in
this
little box of a place on top of some bags of potting soil, and these cacti just crawled their way in. It was. It's still upsetting in a weird way.
So Kris, what does Nika's dream mean for that? Tell us.
No, like let me recommend this to you, Nika, too. Yeah. Like, have you read any of Thomas Ligotti, the author that I jammed down everybody's throat when I'm talking about this stuff?
Drinking water out of a tall glass.
Please find him and please read his stuff. He has
Ligotti,
Ligotti.
L-I-G?
L-I-G. And that goes for everybody else if you like that.
T-T-I.
If you like that real existential broad, like it is not like anything I've read. It's like Lovecraft but without the racism. So
it sounds delightful.
It's like he figured it out. Like you can do that kind of stuff but not be a jackass. But he has a story called The Career of Nightmares. And it's a very short one. But all it does is describe it. He talks about a lot of stuff that I've never seen anybody mention, and that is one of the specific things too, where you enter a dream, and it is like it's populated before you get there, and everything is freighted with whatever meanings it requires to drop you into the scenario, and you yourself too are preloaded with it. You know what I mean? Like you go into your house. Like I'm going to my friend's house, and it's like your friend's house plus your house. And you know, and it's like, and it's all, and then you wake up and you think about it. Oh, this is my kitchen. Like I know all those spaces. That wasn't my friend's house, but in the dream, you know, it was your friend's house. Or it's like my coworker was there, but I knew that he was my brother. You know, it's just like that's just a part of the dream. God, it's such a
identities change where you're like, oh, this is my friend. It's Sean, but it's also Brad. How does that work? Like later on in the dream, it will also become that other person. Like these things are so stupid. And what you talked about is the idea of dreams and how, in a way, I think they know how to paralyze you. You know what scares you most. And in the moments of that vulnerability, your brain knows what to do to bus with you. You know, it's gonna mess with you up here.
Why?
Yeah. Oh, God.
Chica, no.
Why?
You bad, Chica.
No.
And it didn't do a damn thing.
I wasn't scared. I was just actually incredibly surprised and happy. I'm thrilled to see Chica. I actually, Five Nights at Freddy's did scare me to such an extent where I was afraid. You know how, like, there's peepholes on the door?
Yeah.
And I was afraid if someone knocked on the door, if I looked out, what if I saw one of the mannequins? What if I saw, like, Chica or Foxy or something? Mm-hmm. Nope. Like, little things like that, you know, where it gets into your mind. You create it for yourself. Being scared is about you knowing how to creep yourself out better than anyone else. And
I remember.
Yeah, that's very smart.
Liz keeps looking at me like she's really regretting Spoopy Hour.
I am full embracing Spoopy Hour. It just reminded me of a fear that I had for a really long time, longer probably than I should have, and that was of shower curtains. Like, if I went back to the bathroom, I think there's just a vulnerability that happens with the bathroom.
You always have to look behind those things.
Yeah, and, like, going to someone's house or someplace new, like, going into the bathroom, the shower curtain's closed, and I was like, anyone could be there. Mm-hmm. Anyone could be. Like, so I will, like, open them and then see that there's no one there, close it, and then be like, no, let's just keep it open. Just in case things change. Yeah. Never know. And then do my business. Yeah.
I try to remind myself, like, if this person really just wants to sit here and listen to people pee, like, you know, let them do their thing. Like, it's okay. They have more issues than I do right now.
You have a lot of confidence, Tara, and it is inspiring.
It was until American Horror Story. Maybe I caught them in a bad time. And then that fear came back.
They're more scared of you peeing than you are. They're in the shower right now going, how do I get out of this awkward situation? Yeah. And you're just doing your business. Like,
and you're taking forever.
It's funny, too, because it's like, we have that, the reaction we have to those things is generally, you walk into the washroom, you sit down, and then all of a sudden you realize, you're like, I didn't check behind the shower curtain, but now I'll do that. And then you would open the shower curtain because you can reach it from where you're sitting, perhaps. And that in itself is kind of a dumb thing. It's like you've just revealed the person who's about to do you harm, or the thing. It doesn't even be a person. The thing's about to do you harm. And while I have that, so I don't ever leave the shower curtain fully extended, whenever I'm done a shower, it's like I put that thing halfway closed so that when I come in, I can see into the whatever. But I do this in my car. Whenever I get into my car at night, even in the locked garage that I park it in, first thing I do is I get in, I sit down, I start the car, I buckle up, and then I turn around and look in the back seat.
Oh, yes. Right, the back seat with the... Oh.
Because I have heavily tinted windows as well, so I can't see into from outside, but I really should be checking the back seat before I get in and strap myself in.
I've strapped myself in. No, murderer, let's talk.
Yeah, it's always at night.
Oh, hello.
How's your night going, murderer? Yes. You been successful tonight yet? Because you've been waiting here a long time. You didn't know I was going out for Burger King right now. You didn't know.
I'll let you finish it, because that would be really mean of me to just, like, leave you sitting down for a meal and...
You know what?
You really want chicken fingers. Just
Do you want me, Fang? Yeah, some chicken fries.
That'd be good.
Okay. Anything to wash down? Anything? Some Sprite would be great.
No, I'm good. I'll just drink your blood. It's good. It's just the fries I want. Yeah.
The best advice I ever had that I've heard, Merlin Mann on a podcast once said that, and this is a real life thing, he said, they can't eat you. Like, no matter what you're going to, like, if you run into your boss, if you run into, like, a coworker, if you run into, like, you know, an ex or something like that, it's like, no matter what bad thing is about to happen, they can't eat you. But we have dreams about that all the time, right? Where something bad is about to happen to you, and you have that real fear, like, it's like, I'm going to be consumed, and I'm going to be gone, and I'm going to be in this oblivion state, and no one's going to, you know, it's all that kind of stuff. It's always about getting removed and consumed and gone and something else, and this bad thing happening to you, and yet in real life, we know for a fact that that can't happen. You don't walk into your boss's office and he says, all right, you screwed up on the report, now I get to eat you.
I don't know. Have you read my stories? They're surprisingly cannibalistic. Or maybe not surprising if you've read my stories. I think that there is something to that. And it's not only the idea of being... you know, completely wasted away, just disappearing. That's one thing. But then there's the idea of the slow, painful problem. Now, a lot of people have dreams where they die, right? Mm. Like, some people have that, apparently people are hit the ground and then they wake up right before then. I don't. in dreams where I die, I stay dead and I experience death, and it's what? Not okay.
What,
yeah,
is, what is death like?
Paralysis. It's like, it's the worst. You're sitting there and you're still there and you know that there's nothing going on. It's like, I've never had a dream where I've died but not lived afterwards in a completely horrendous way. Like, I don't have the wake-up moment right beforehand. It's so bad. So and, like, I guess I have weird dreams. I don't have the teeth dream, for instance.
Huh.
Like, none of them. Like, I've never had a dental dream.
That sounds nice.
Which is the coolest thing I've ever said.
Did you have a
story? Well, I was going to comment on what Beej said about checking and making sure that things aren't there. There's a bathroom in my house, and it's just sort of an individual bathroom where it's just a sink and a toilet, and it has a very high ceiling. And at some point, I think I had a dream where it was, I walked into the bathroom, and I was for some reason in the third person, and it was the thing where you walk in the bathroom, and then the camera pans up, and there's something on the ceiling.
Yeah.
And it's just like, it's something big and horrible, and just the whole, like, I like rub my eyes, I wash my hands, and it's just like sitting there slowly moving.
Is it
and
a
so-
giant spider?
It's varied.
Yes, it is.
Oh. It is, in fact, a giant spider, plant, bear.
It's the biggest one.
Oh, spider, bears are the worst.
Terrifying.
About
but,
that one.
So now every time I wind up going to that bathroom, I'm just like, right, I'm inside. Make sure there's nothing on the ceiling. Yeah. All right,
check
good.
The ceiling first.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Okay. I had a bathroom or at my parents' house. My childhood bathroom is very small. Toilet sink. And if you are going to stand up and pee, you are looking out a window. There's no curtains on this window. And if it's nighttime, there's nothing back there. We didn't have any lights back there. It's just a backyard. It's pitch black. So you have no sense of depth. And in like in every horrible evening or, you know, midnight micturation I've ever had, like a face would just float up at, you know, at the window.
Oh my God,
like, so why would you do that to a house? Just go ahead and put some blinds there. Nobody wants to look out the window while they're peeing anymore.
Where's Nika going? What is she gonna show us?
That reminds me of something I just found out about today. I think it might be in Thailand or perhaps in China. People have got these stickers that they can put on their rear windows that you can't really see them. It's to encourage people not to use their high beams. When you turn your high beams on, all of a sudden horror faces in the back window of the car in front of you.
Nika is so delighted.
Yeah, it's amazing. I think
so
I saw
scare
it on
yourself.
Like Geekology today or something, but I'm sure it wouldn't be hard to find on the Googles.
That's amazing.
I want those forever. I'm going to put them on every surface.
Yeah.
If I want to use my car driving
so
by my
as
tiny,
as that.
Stupid vehicle. It's just a ghost mobile.
Yeah.
It's terrifying.
That's so fun. Kris, I wanted to mention, I don't think, I hate to plug something that is not either of ours, but in the same way, I got this book. I would say it's an illustrated, I wouldn't say it's a comic book, but it's more of a picture book, and it's spooky. And it's by Ben Catmull, and it's called Ghosts and Ruins.
Ooh,
and it's all about haunted houses. It's very, very small, incredibly small poetic stories with interesting illustrations. And this is, you know how like, well, Twilight Zone does this to me where it's like you read up or you think of a tiny thing and it gets you going on everything. This is full of that and also scary. Like it lets you fill in the blanks for what is happening and it is so good. I sleep with it now. I'm scared of it, so I sleep with it a lot.
I'm gonna look it up.
It's so good. It's so good.
I read something kind of similar recently, and I'm forgetting the exact title, but I think it's Into the Woods or something like that. It's about going into the woods. It's a graphic novel.
Emily Carroll.
Yes.
She's amazing.
And
she's the best.
I was like, I can totally handle a horror graphic novel. It's not gonna scare me. Some of those stories I still think about. There's one specifically about like people that. Or these creatures, maybe from a different planet, but they come in and are essentially body snatchers. Like they take over someone's body, and it's someone that you love. In this case, it's like her brother and sister-in-law or something, I think. And that you don't know that there are these people until it's too late, and they turn you into it. And there are still days that I'll like turn to my husband and be like, I really hope he's not one of these things. Like, how will I
know?
What's
the one? What's the one that she did about the prince and the mermaid? You know that one?
I'm trying to remember.
Look, they're all great.
She has a bunch of them on her website, and some of them are animated. Ooh, she has, like, it's super upsetting. It's perfect. Like, some of the ones in the book were, most of them were new, but some of the ones I'd seen from the website, and I just spent hours on there, and I love her. She's Emily Terrible, I think, on Twitter. But yeah. find her stuff.
She's the best.
It's like beautifully and gory, like the type of the illustration she does. It's just, it's stunning, and it's a lot of those end in that same way where, like, she doesn't spell out exactly what happens, but you know.
And they're slow, right? Yeah. Like, they're not like blah blah. It's like, it's very slow and paced and thoughtful and lyrical, and it's just well done. It's just, she's the best one doing it.
Yeah. It's why I envy you, Kris, because you can also draw the things that you see. Like, I have to, like, write them all out so other people can do that. But you, with Root Hollow and your other Nika, stuff, like,
it's so much harder to write it. It's so much harder to write it out.
Look at the love.
No, it's incredible. It's incredible to have the combination of those talents. The thing that says, here is a story, and here is it concisely given with these visual cues, with this art that goes so perfectly along with it, that you're creating almost a storyboard for something that's really incredible. And I see that in comics. And yours in particular has always astounded me. Like, I love Brute Hollow. I haven't caught up with it for a while, and I'm sorry.
Me neither.
I was terrified of it. Like, it was a beautiful story. And again, it's about the combination of the two. It's the art creates the story, creates the art, and so forth. So it's like you have
to.
I'm
gonna give you the same back, because I'm really envious of your writing, and sometimes I think about not having to draw something. It's like, why can't I can write too? I can write something scary, just describe it instead, and make it a book or a story instead of a comic. And then I sit down, I'm like, this phrase sounds dumb. This sounds dumb. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you have this inkling of deeper thought that is it's reachable, but you know, the hallway keeps expanding and the door keeps getting further and further, and I write it down, it's like this trash, and then it's like as soon as I try to resolve it on the page, it's garbage. But you have overcome that. And
I got nothing else, honey. Like,
the chat says now keys. You guys are amazing. Yeah.
We'll touch books.
I'm gonna take books and try to
tip.
This style. Aww. I'm gonna take, like, your books and just press them against my head and, like, hope that I learn art.
That's how you learn art. Them,
and then we'll just sell that object.
Work together. All right. So now, new project. Nika's gonna write a book. Kris is gonna draw it. You guys are gonna do this project, and we'll talk about it next year. Okay, great.
Could I? I want to ask Kris a question, actually. Because you're a father of a, and you have a very young child.
Your father.
Oh. I wish. We'll get there. You obviously, then you're probably going to start running into the childhood terrors, do you have a plan on, because you're steeping yourself very heavily in the horror genre these days. Are you looking at this like, I have to somehow, you know, how am I going to deal with this? How do I approach this and help my child move through this? Do you have ideas for that?
Yeah, I think that I just need to show them that life is misery and that, you know, I just closed the page because I was looking up Ligotti quotes, and I was just going to read it aloud. Never mind. No, I think that, like, it's a big difference, because it's one thing if I'm, like, by myself and I'm feeling these horrible, it's like I'm concerned about these horrible things and these ghosts and whatever. And it's another thing if somebody you're trying to protect is worried about it. And then immediately you're like, oh, it's all fake, though. It's all nonsense. Because you have to be able to hang on to that if you want to comfort them.
Yeah.
I thought what you were going to ask was, like, because he's old enough to have nightmares now, have I encountered any of the stuff there? I'll tell you a sad one, and then I'll tell you a scary one.
Yeah.
Maybe I'll do it in the opposite order. No, it's no fun if I give you the sad one last, because it's actually sad. So a couple of times, if he gets super exhausted, and that especially happens after we've traveled and he doesn't get his nap, and we actually just came down to, Nika, I'm in Los Angeles right now. Are you also?
Yes.
We just flew down today.
Chris?
Okay, what are we doing?
Let's make this book. Apparently talking to you on Skype about what my plans are.
Yeah, everybody's invited. But anyway, so if he's overtired, he'll have, basically they're like night terrors. And the mode they took, I think he's only had them like twice, but he is having a bad dream and you cannot wake him up. Mm. And so he started yelling and he was saying, like we could make it out through his crying. He was saying, Mama come back, Dada gone. And we are like, we're here. We pick him up, we're rocking, we're here. He's asleep. He is in a world where what he's saying is true. Mama come back, Dada gone. And how do you, he wakes up eventually, but my God, like you can, I mean, we don't smack him or anything like that, but like he's resilient to waking up. And that is terrifying. So that's a sad one. He hasn't done that in a long time. The scary one was my wife Marla and I were like talking over him because we were sharing a bed with him and he sleeps between us, and so we were just talking about I forget what. And I think we were saying like, do you think he's dreaming right now? What do you think he's, because he was kind of like moving about, and he just goes, face man.
Oh no.
And I was like, oh my God.
Oh no.
Not the, please not the face man.
Not
and
the
I don't
face,
get to
man.
Know what that means. And I'm like, is it a man made of faces? Does he steal them?
I think like, what he actually looks like is irrelevant. The terror
just
is like, what
right.
could it
to
possibly
add more
look
to
like?
It, is to spoil it. Yeah, that moment yeah. is the scary part. There's no point in elaborating on it. Yeah, it's good. It's good stuff. Wow. Give me a lot to think on. I prayed on it.
Kids have the scariest things to think and say because they have no barrier. They have no, like all of us were scared by technically nonsensical things. I think our dreams make sense nowadays. I think that when we have these dreams, we can piece them out better. Kids don't have that filter. They have like the pure raw experience of.
They have no data. They don't know what's wrong or right. They don't know what can happen or can't.
They can't process it, and so it just comes back out, and you're like, "That is completely creepy," because it's just completely raw and unfiltered.
I don't. So we were talking. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
Like, and I don't mean to. I don't mean to. Because this is a corollary to that. I don't mean to freak you out for what's to come then, but when I was 12 years old, and one of those times when I feel like I clearly should have known better, but I didn't. I don't know why. So grade 6, for a few months, I had a phobia that when I went to sleep, I would wake up and my dad would no longer exist.
Wow.
Yeah. If I go to sleep, he's gone. And I couldn't tell my parents that because it's ridiculous, right? Because I'm clearly like, in the light of day, it's like, I know better than that. I know, that's stupid. But I would go to bed, and for whatever reason, the lights would go out, and I would just be like, phoomp, and that would be it. And I couldn't make it through the night. I had to have my dad in the room with me while I was trying to sleep.
Aww.
And then once I fell asleep, he could leave. And I didn't want him to, but of course, he'd just get up and do it because I'm asleep then. So.
And then you'd wake up, and he wasn't there because he no longer existed.
I slept hard the whole night. And I wake up in the morning, and it wouldn't even. And then it didn't matter anymore. But for whatever time, that anxiety was like really present, and that touched off a lot of really bad things for a while. For only a few months, and then eventually I saw a book on my parents' nightstand that said "Solving Your Child's Sleep Problems," and I realized I'm like, "Oh wow, my parents are really freaked out about this. They're trying to figure out how to deal with this anxiety
Aww.
Issue." And I never had the problem ever again.
Oh,
because you knew that they were there for you.
So, I'm gonna wrap this up because we have a couple other things we got to do. And
we've had so many spooks.
And I'm too spooped. But thank you both for calling in. Nika, as our surprise guest, where can we find both of you and the stuff that you do? I want you guys to plug yourselves. Go.
Chris.
Okay. You can
I'll talk
find
about
me
where
at,
Chris where I can find Chris. How about that? No, no, just kidding.
Wait, I was going to say, I don't know where I am.
In his hotel room.
Yeah, no. Like, you can find Chris my work. This amazing stuff at blank, 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 et cetera.
No, I'll just give my own. You could find me at chainsawsuit.com. I do a lot of stuff, but you can find it all there. If you want to see some scary stuff, you can go to local58.info, which is where it just goes to my YouTube page for the three scary videos I've done. I wanted to do the facade, but if you go to desertchris.org right now, you may find that it's different from the other content. It's a little different from the other content that it was up earlier.
Had a lot of people ask about it in the chat. You've updated the content?
DesertChris.org.
Chris with a K.
Did you see that when I put that up?
I'm sorry. No. I didn't.
Then this is like a secondary. I was just hoping somebody would stumble on it and get very upset, which is the best kind of horror. It's like you don't lay it out there. You don't put it on a bed for anybody. You just let them find it and get upset later.
Oh, it's
right. No.
I was hoping it would come up.
I'm upset now.
Crawling away.
This is a choice.
Bye, skeletons. No. Bye. I love you. Bye. Bye.
Bye. Thank you for spoops.
Yay, spoops.
Good. I'd say this has been a successful spoopy hour in 15 minutes.
Yes. That was really good. Yeah. We came up with that spoopy idea.